Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fifth meeting for 2021 of the Justice Committee. We have no apologies this morning, and we're joined today by Dean Lockhart, MSP, Joanne Lamont, MSP, and Hamza Yousaf, MSP, the Cabinet Secretary for Justice. I welcome you all to our meeting. We may also be joined later on this morning by Liz Smith, MSP, if we reach her amendments. Our first agenda item this morning is to continue our Stage 2 consideration of the Hate Crime and Public Order Scotland Bill. And members should have with them a copy of the marshalled list and the groupings for debate. Before we start, can I just remind everyone that this is a fully virtual meeting and that we will use the chat function on BlueJeans as the means of voting electronically today. So what that means is that when we vote, I'll call members to type Y in the chat function to record any votes for yes, and then I'll do the same for no and abstain. The clerks will then collate the results and I'll read them out and confirm them. If a mistake is made in this process, members, please let me know immediately by typing R or help or something else appropriate in the chat box before we move to the next vote, as once we do move to the next vote, we can't go back. And if we lose connection with anybody at any point, I'll suspend the meeting to try and get the member back into the meeting. If we can't do so after a reasonable time, then the Deputy Convener and I will have to make a call as to whether we can proceed or whether we will have to abandon the meeting. I hope that is reasonably clear. We've done this before, but for the benefit of members of the public who may be tuning in who aren't used to how we do this online, I hope that's helpful. And unless there are any questions or comments on any of that, we can make a start. Moving to the next group for debate. This is a group on disaggregation of data relating to hate crime. And I call Amendment 32 in the name of Dean Lockhart, group with Amendments 59 and 99. Dean Lockhart to move Amendment 32 and speak to other amendments in the group. Good morning, Dean.
Good morning, Convener. Thank you very much and good morning, committee members. My Amendments 32 and 59 provide for the disaggregation of data with respect to different offences committed under the legislation. The committee report at paragraph 386 noted evidence from witnesses that more could be done to improve how hate crime offences are recorded and monitored under the legislation. Witnesses also highlighted the importance of ensuring consistency of approach across Scotland, for example, within Police Scotland, when it comes to recording offences under the legislation. Paragraph 381 of the committee report highlighted the evidence given by the Equality Network and Victim Support Scotland, who have called for a legal requirement for the bill to be integrated into the bill that places a duty on the Scottish Government, Police Scotland and any other relevant duty bearers to develop a bespoke system of hate crime data collection and disaggregation across all characteristics covered by the bill. My understanding is that under other legislative frameworks in Scotland, where any statutory aggravation is proven, the court is required to state on conviction that the offence is aggravated by prejudice relating to the characteristic in question, record the conviction so that it shows the relevant aggregation and take that aggregation into account in sentencing. I'm not certain that the hate crime bill as currently drafted replicates this, and therefore my amendments seek to ensure this is covered. Evidence was also given by the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service that the bill as currently drafted, they would struggle under the bill as currently drafted to record incidents in the way that they currently do. Again, my amendments seek to address these issues. The Cabinet Secretary has lodged Amendment 99, which also deals with data disaggregation, but in a different context. So I look forward to hearing from the Cabinet Secretary as to whether he considers that his Amendment 99 addresses all of the issues raised by the stakeholders groups, which I've just described, in relation to data disaggregation and the recording requirements under the legislation. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Dean. I ask the Cabinet Secretary, I call the Cabinet Secretary now, please, to speak to Amendment 99 and other amendments in the group.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning to all the members present today at this Stage 2 session of the Justice Committee. I hope everybody is doing well. I will speak to Amendments 32 and 59 in the name of Dean Lockhart and, as you said, Amendment 99 in my name. I recognise very much, as Dean Lockhart has just said, the value of data and evidence on hate crime in Scotland, and the fact that this needs to be improved. That it needs to show a greater level of disaggregation. It needs to tell us more about victims and indeed perpetrators. Such data is essential in our work to more effectively tackle hate crime. A number of stakeholders, again, as just has been referenced, quite rightly have been calling for improved data on hate crime for several years. Most recently, these calls included a request for there to be additional statutory requirements to publish more information on hate crime. Now, like our stakeholders, I want to see this level of data published on a regular and sustainable basis. I'm delighted to have the support of Police Scotland and of BMIS as I bring forward Amendment 99, which relates to information recorded by the police rather than, for example, convictions or charges reported to the Crown Office. This is important as it will provide vital information at the very earliest stage of the justice system on what groups are being targeted and how these crimes come to the police's attention. We know underreporting of hate crime is a key issue that must be tackled, and having the data and evidence to inform our response will ensure it's effective and provides the necessary support for victims. So we're working with Police Scotland to ensure their new crime management system will have the capability of capturing disaggregated data where it's available, and as I say, on a sustainable basis. Amendment 99 provides a very clear framework for reporting data under that new system, and indeed creates a legal duty for such reports to be provided annually. Now, until Police Scotland has those systems in place to extract this data, I'm happy to give a commitment that for at least the reporting year of 2021, which covers the exceptional circumstances of the COVID pandemic, the Scottish Government will produce a further study, a deep dive into the characteristics of police-recorded hate crime. In terms of Dean Lockhart's amendments, Amendments 32 and 59, they consider the very opposite end of the justice system with a focus on convictions data. I absolutely support the intention behind these provisions. There are some significant challenges, though, associated with their implementation. At the moment, courts are unable to provide this level of data. SCTS have told us that it would not be possible to implement with the systems that they currently use. Now, that doesn't mean it won't be possible in the future. And I think having disaggregated data on convictions is an important ambition. But if such an amendment is to work in practice to deliver the improved disaggregated data we agree is needed, it could benefit from further refinement, including through some engagement with the Crown and with SCTS. Further, the amendment requires Scottish Government ministers to prescribe these subcategories in regulations. Well, I do understand the intention there is to give clarity. My approach to Amendment 99, I consider, would be more advantageous. It provides a degree of flexibility that perhaps Dean Lockhart's amendments do not do. And this is particularly important given the difficulties the court's current systems have, as I've just explained. There is a further technical difficulty with the amendment. It requires Scottish ministers to make regulations. Those are subject to the affirmative procedure. So, of course, I recognise the importance of rigorous scrutiny that the affirmative procedure can provide. But combined with a mandatory duty to make regulations, it may have the unintended effect that should such regulations not be approved by Parliament, Scottish ministers would then be unable to meet that legal duty. So I would ask Dean Lockhart not to press Amendments 32 or 59, but I'm happy to work with him if he wishes in advance of Stage 3, with potentially developing a provision on disaggregated data and convictions that could be lodged at Stage 3, noting that there will have to be factored into that. Considerable time will be needed to develop systems capability by SCTS before that amendment or provision in the bill, if it is passed, be commenced or indeed enabled. And I would ask members to support Amendment 99 in my name.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Two members have indicated that they would wish to speak in this debate. So can I call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Rhoda Grant, please. Liam.
Thanks, Convener. I'll be very brief. It was just to indicate both for the principle of Dean Lockhart's amendment, as the Cabinet Secretary has identified, there may be some weaknesses in the framing of that amendment, but I think the principle is a very sound one. Indeed, it's a principle that the committee over the course of this session of Parliament has had cause to return to on a few occasions. So that disaggregated data, I think, is very much in the public interest And I think if a way can be found at stage three to address the concerns the Cabinet Secretary has justifiably flagged up, I think that would lead to an improvement in the bill. So I welcome that that offer, but thank Dean Melcourt for lodging his amendment.
Thank you, Ian. Can I call Rhoda Grant, please? Rhoda.
Thank you, Convener. I won't repeat what others have said. I'm in agreement with already been said, but just to make the point, that would be very important to have both police data and conviction data, because then we would be able to see any difference between the two figures, and indeed if there was more work to be coming out from certain inspections.
Thank you. Could I invite Dean Lockhart to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 32, please? Dean.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his remarks, and Liam MacArthur and Rhoda Grant. The limitations of existing systems are understood, and I do welcome the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to look at those limitations and address some of those limitations so that further disaggregation of data under the legislation can be provided for. In that sense, I look forward to working with Cabinet Secretary between now and stage three to take disaggregation of data under the legislation as far as it can go. And in that respect, Convener, I will not move or press Amendment 32 or Amendment 59.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lockhart. So Mr. Lockhart wishes to withdraw Amendment 32. Are members content? Members are content. So we move. So the next question is that Section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. We move to the next group, which is the group concerning the offence of racially aggravated harassment. I call Amendment 33 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary group, with amendments as shown in the groupings. And I would point out that if Amendment 24 in the group removal of provisions ancillary to Sections 3 and 5 is agreed, I cannot call Amendment 64. The Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 33 and to speak to all amendments in the group. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. I move Amendment 33 in my name. It is the only substantial amendment in this group. Amendment 33 inserts a new part after Section 2 of the bill. The new part contains one section. This new section provides for an offence of racially aggravated harassment. This offence restates Section 50A of the Criminal Law Consolidation Scotland Act 1995. With some very minor adjustments made to the wording for consistency with the equivalent wording in Part 1 of the Bill. The remaining amendments in this group are consequential on the insertion of this section by Amendment 33. Lord Bracondale recommended that we should repeal Section 50A of the Criminal Law Consolidation Scotland Act 95, the offence of racially aggravated harassment. He argued that the offending behaviour caught by that particular offence could mostly be captured and recorded by other offences with the addition of a racial aggravation. However, we heard quite clearly from stakeholders that repealing this offence could send and would send potentially the wrong message. It could be particularly damaging in terms of tackling racial hatred within Scotland, especially if such a removal could be at the very least perceived as a weakening of the criminal law protection in the area of race. In addition, the 2019-2020 Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service reports that 1,208 charges under Section 50A, a staggering 40% of all race hate crimes reported by the Crown Office that year. As I've set out previously, I believe a distinct approach for race is needed. It recognises the seriousness of racial hatred as well as the impact it has on community cohesion. And listening to the Justice Committee's scrutiny of the bill at stage one, I took cognizance of the calls to consolidate the offence of racially aggravated harassment into the bill. This would maintain the distinct approach on race while ensuring all hate crime legislation could be found in one place. Me and my officials have engaged with a number of racial equality organisations, and I know the importance to them of maintaining this offence in Scots law. At the same time, I know these organisations are also anxious that any move to consolidate does not alter the practical effects of the offence, or nor how the courts prosecute it. So Amendment 33 therefore aims to consolidate the existing offence of racially aggravated harassment into the bill. I am happy to leave it there as opposed to speak to the consequential amendments. I hope members will support the consolidation of this offence into the bill, and I move Amendment 33 in my name.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Two members have indicated so far that they would like to speak in this debate. So can I call Liam MacArthur? And after Liam MacArthur, it would be John Finney. Liam.
Thanks again, Convener. And as with the previous grouping, I'll be brief. I very much understand and sympathise with the rationale for not adopting the approach that's now being proposed in the original bill. I think sending a message that there be any dilution or weakening of the protections in relation to racial nature is one we need to take seriously. But from the evidence that we heard, I think it was pretty compelling that, that there would be no dilution, there would be no weakening. And indeed, with the consolidation, I think comes a greater opportunity for the law to be clear, comprehensible, and therefore enforceable. So I would hope that those groups that the Cabinet Secretary has been speaking with over recent weeks will take some reassurance from that. Certainly the message from this committee is that there should be no dilution or weakening. The practical effect of the changes in Amendment 33 are simply those of consolidation, and that should be the message coming out from the committee. But I welcome Amendment 33.
Thank you very much, Liam. Can I call John Finney, please?
Thank you, Convener, and really simply to echo everything that Liam MacArthur has said there, I think there's two things that are important here. I think there's an administrative approach, and this was either consolidating legislation or it wasn't, and that aspect did stand aside. So I'm delighted to see the incorporation. I'm also delighted that the discussions that the Cabinet Secretary has had with the racial equality groups, because we are aware no one wanted any any dilution, excuse me. And it is very clear that racism requires a different approach. So I'm delighted at the incorporation. I think that hopefully that these groups are reassured that this was never about diluting protections that have long been in place. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Finney. I mean, I would just like to associate myself also with the remarks of Mr. MacArthur and Mr. Finney. I'm delighted to see this offence consolidated into this legislation. And I should very much share the view that there is no dilution of protections associated with this step. So I very much welcome this amendment. No other member has indicated that they wish to speak in this debate, Cabinet Secretary. So can I invite you to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 33?
I will press Amendment 33 in my name, and I'm certain that most of the racial equality, if not all of the racial equality groups who I've engaged with, the committee's engaged with, will take great comfort from all of the assurance and reassurances given by members that none of us want to see any dilution. So I think the Stage 1 report recommended the consolidation of 50A. There was a sensible suggestion, a sensible approach, and I'm delighted to move Amendment 33 in my name.
Excellent. Thank you very much. So the question is that Amendment 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. So we move to the next group. Which is a large group and a complex group because it has a number of preemptions in it. So let me try and take us through it. This is a group concerning the threshold for and operation of offences relating to stirring up hatred. And I call Amendment 34 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. And I draw members' attention to the preemption information on this group contained in the groupings document, namely, if Amendment 34 is agreed, I cannot call Amendment 35. If Amendment 36 is agreed, I cannot call Amendment 37. If Amendment 39 is agreed, I cannot call Amendment 9. If Amendment 40 is agreed, I cannot call Amendment 10. So, with that in mind, can I invite the Cabinet Secretary please to move Amendment 34 and speak to all other and speak to all amendments in the group, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Convener, and of course I move Amendment 34 in my name and will speak to all of the other amendments in the group. So forgive me, as you say, it's a large grouping, this one, but I'll try to be as succinct as I can for each amendment. I want to start with Amendments 1 to 4 in my name. As members know, the bill creates a new stirring up hatred offence that applies to the characteristics of age, disability, religion, sexual orientation, transgender identity, and variations in sex characteristics. These characteristics do not currently have a stirring up hatred offence associated with them in Scotland, Amendments 1 to 4 relate to those new stirring up of hatred offences. Expanding the offences of stirring up hatred to cover these further characteristics did cause concern about the inadvertent impact that such offences could have on people's right to freely discuss controversial ideas about, for example, religion. In light of the concerns raised, I made the decision, which I announced in Parliament in September last year, that amendments would be lodged that would seek to make the stirring up of offences for all characteristics except race require an intention to stir up hatred as an essential element of the offence. Amendments 1 to 4 make good on that commitment, and I'd ask members to therefore support them. Amendments 2 and 4 remove the likely to stir up hatred limb of the new stirring up hatred offences in Section 3.2b, Section 5.2b of the Bill. Amendments 1 and 3 are consequential. The convener, it's worth highlighting at this time that I will be supporting Liam Kerr's Amendment 19, which seeks to remove Section 5 from the Bill. Therefore, my Amendments 3 and 4, which adjust Section 5, are relevant only if Amendment 19 to be debated in a future grouping is not agreed to. Amendments 34, 36, 38, 39 and 40 in my name ensure it is clear that there is an objective standard against which behaviour or material must be assessed for the purposes of the stirring up hatred offences in the Bill. For an offence to be committed under Section 3, as we know, a person requires to have engaged in conduct or communicated material which is threatening, abusive, or in the case of characteristics relating to race, insulting. There has been public and stakeholder concern as to who gets to decide whether something is abusive under the Bill. I know this is an issue, Convener, you in particular have pressed the government on. There may be a perception that reliance will be placed on the subjective views of individuals, which could result in people being investigated for criminal prosecution for very spurious allegations that do not, in any sensible view, amount to abusive behaviour. Similar concerns could equally apply to what amounts to threatening or insulting behaviour. It's for this reason I agree with the committee and indeed the convener that it's best to include provisions in the Bill that clarifies and puts beyond doubt the nature of the test to be applied when interpreting these terms. And the best way to do that is by reference to the objective standard of a reasonable person test. That is what Amendments 34, 36, 39 and 40 seek to do. In addition, Amendment 38 adds a reasonable person test to the likely effect of a person's behaviour or communication for the stirring up racial hatred offence. And this applies an objective standard as to whether the effect of a person's behaviour or communication is likely to result in hatred being stirred up against a group defined by race, and that includes colour, nationality, citizenship, or ethnic or national origins. Liam Kerr's Amendments 42 and 45 pick up the same issue about objectivity within the stirring up hatred offences, and while these are well-intentioned, they are more limited in scope than my amendments in this area, as they do not relate to behaviour or material that may be insulting or likely to stir up hatred. In addition, I decided that clarity in the Bill would be best done at the place where the thresholds of the offence are provided, so my amendments are made to Section 3.1 and Section 3.2 of the Bill directly, whereas these amendments are added to the ends of Section 3 and 5. So the overall policy aims for my amendments and Liam Kerr's amendments are broadly the same, but because my amendments, I would suggest, go further in terms of policy and I think are more transparent and consistent with the reading of the Bill, I would ask members to support my amendments. Liam Kerr has also lodged Amendments 39A and 40A to remove the term abusive from Amendments 39 and 40. These are consequential changes required if his Amendments 9 and 10 are agreed. I will shortly explain my position on his substantive Amendments 9 and 10, but for the reasons I will give, I would ask members to oppose Amendments 39A and 40A. In a similar vein, Dean Lockhart has lodged Amendments 34A and 36A. These amendments are consequential to his Amendments 35 and 37, which remove insulting from the threshold of the stirring up racial hatred offence. Again, for the reasons I will give shortly in discussing his substantive amendments 35 and 37, I'd ask members to oppose 34A and 36A. Convener, Liam Kerr has lodged Amendment 17, which would remove Section 3 of the Bill in its entirety. When read together with Schedule 2 of the Bill, Amendment 17, if agreed, would result in there being no offences of stirring up hatred in Scots law, including for racial hatred. That is not the recommendation of the Stage 1 report, and I would ask members to reject Amendment 17. The amendment has no regard to the existing legal landscape, both in Scotland and across the UK, where offences of stirring up hatred are not new. It would remove the long-standing UK-wide laws that exist to protect people from suffering racial hatred in Scotland, and it would result in Scotland having by far the weakest protections in the area of stirring up hatred across the whole of the United Kingdom. Convener, behaviour that stirs up hatred is corrosive. I think it's something we've all recognised. It can result in entire communities feeling isolated, scared, and very, very vulnerable to attack. In the most serious cases, of course, it can directly encourage activity which threatens or endangers life. Convener, I'm afraid that Liam Kerr's Amendment 17, it turns its back on all the victims of hate crime, and I hope members will vote against Amendment 17, which, if agreed to, would set a very harmful precedent for Scotland. Now, Liam Kerr has also lodged Amendments 9, 10 and 18, which seek to remove the threshold of abusive from the operation of the new offences related to the stirring up of hatred in the bill. Amendments 25 and 27 are consequential to these amendments. Amendments 9, 10 excuse me, and 18, if agreed to, would mean the new offences relating to stirring up hatred would be restricted to threatening behaviour or material intended to stir up hatred, or possession of threatening material with a view to communicating it to stir up hatred. Conduct that amounts to abusive behaviour would never be subject to criminal sanction under Part 2 of the bill, even if such abusive behaviour or material was intended to stir up hatred. I cannot support Amendments 9, 10, 18, 25 or 27, which do not take into account the legal context in Scotland, or indeed the Justice Committee's own recommendations, unanimous recommendations in this area. As a matter of criminal law policy, I consider it's appropriate that abusive behaviour is included as part of the offences relating to stirring up hatred. Scotland has its own statutory offence, as we know, of threatening or abusive behaviour, which has existed since 2010, which has been prosecuted in criminal courts in Scotland at literally thousands of times. And the police, Scottish courts, legal practitioners are well used to consider what is abusive behaviour, and this has been affirmed during the bill's scrutiny by those representing the legal profession and indeed Police Scotland themselves. The importance of getting the balance right between protecting people from hate crime while respecting freedom of expression is, of course, critical and something I know we all agree with. Removing abusive conduct from the scope of the new offences relating to stirring up hatred does not, in my view, achieve that correct balance. So I'd urge members to vote against Amendments 9, 10, 18, 25 and 27. Amendments 35 and 37 from Dean Lockhart, they seek to remove the threshold of insulting from the operation of the offence of the stirring up racial hatred provision, which is provided for in Section 3.1 of the bill. This is the threshold that has operated in Scotland, as well as England, Wales and Northern Ireland for more than 30 years. Removing it would mean that Scotland has the weakest stirring up of racial hatred protection within the UK. Unfortunately, there's no denying the prevalence of racial hatred crime offending in Scotland. I know that from personal experience, but the committee heard that from a number of the racial equality groups who attended your oral evidence session at stage one. It's a sad reality that two-thirds of all recorded hate crime in Scotland relate to race. The bill recognises the particularly damaging impact racial hatred crime has on community cohesion, which could be worsened if there was a perception that protections in hate crime law were being weakened in this area. And we just heard from members in a previous group how we would not want to give any impression that the law in relation to racial hatred was being diluted in any way. There is, of course, a distinct approach for race reflected in also the English and Welsh stirring up hatred provisions in the Public Order Act of 1986. My position is that any changes which give rise to the perception of the weakening of the existing long-standing protections in this area must give everybody pause for thought. There was compelling testimony, as I say, from a number of groups that appeared at committee, that taking a distinct approach for the stirring up of racial hatred offences justifies the retention of the existing threshold of insulting. I firmly believe that if there was a perception of the weakening of the racial stirring up offences, then that could cause difficulty in terms of, as I say, at least of perception of the criminal law, and that is not a risk I would be willing to take. So I'd ask members to oppose Amendments 35 and 37. Amendments 41, 44 and 84 have been lodged by Liam Kerr. Amendments 41 and 44 appear to add the requirement of a public element or an offence to be committed under Sections 3 and 5 of the Bill, where the offending conduct takes place in a private dwelling. Amendment 84 is consequential. The public element provided for by Amendments 41 and 44 does not extend to what people in other dwellings may see or hear. So if the words or behaviours are seen or heard by, say, neighbours within their dwellings, in an upstairs or downstairs flat, that would not constitute a public element, which means no stirring up hatred offence would be committed. The public element instead seems to require people in public places, e.g. on a street pavement, to see or hear the words or behaviour before an offence can be committed. Convener, in my view, these are entirely artificial distinctions which fail to recognise that when the offence of stirring up hatred occurs within a dwelling, that does not avoid the potential wider harmful impacts such offences to prevent. For example, damage to local community cohesion, feelings of victimisation by neighbours, the incitement of acts of violence may occur in a dwelling, but the effects can be felt by behaviour taking place in public to the detriment of the targeted group. We must also be very careful of the potential unintended adverse consequences of such amendments. The effect of Liam Kerr's Amendments 41, 44 and 84 is that a person using some sort of video, teleconference, internet live stream, chat room function may be able to escape criminal liability if it is not possible to prove that anyone who saw or heard the communication was outside a private dwelling at the time. Amendments 41 and 44 would create an obvious glaring omission in the law by allowing people to continue to stir up hatred from the confines of their own home to a wider audience where that audience was within their own dwellings or even another person's dwelling at the time of viewing. If someone behaves in a threatening or abusive manner or communicates threatening or abusive material with the intention of stirring up hatred, I consider the criminal law should be capable of addressing such behaviour, whether it takes place within a private dwelling or out with. As has been recognised by legal and academic stakeholders, the criminal law is often concerned with what goes on inside people's homes, and rightly so. We heard from Michael Clancy at Stage 1 Oral Evidence Committee, and he said, I quote, "There is no sanctuary in that sense for most aspects of the criminal law, and I do not think that there should be a sanctuary when it comes to hate speech." I very much agree with Michael Clancy, and I would urge members to vote against Amendments 41, 44 and 84. Amendment 55 from Liam Kerr inserts a requirement into the bill that any prosecution in respect of the stirring up hatred offences in Section 3 of the Bill or Section 5 of the Bill must either be instituted by Crown Council or consent must have been given by Crown Council. The Lord Advocate has written to the committee explaining his views as to why Amendment 55 should not be agreed. This amendment seems to draw on a provision in the Public Order Act 1986 as it applies to England and Wales. That states that proceedings for an offence of stirring up hatred may be instituted in England and Wales only by or with the consent of the Attorney General. The crucial point, of course, is that this only applies to England and Wales. That provision does not apply as it currently stands in Scotland. Now, this is because fundamentally different systems of prosecution apply in Scotland as compared to England and Wales. In practice, all prosecutions in Scotland are brought by public prosecutors who operate within the system of prosecution for which the Lord Advocate is responsible, and they're subject to direction from the Lord Advocate. A private prosecution may be initiated only with the concurrence of the Lord Advocate or the approval of the court, and in practice, private prosecutions are practically unknown. By contrast, in England and Wales, prosecutions can be brought forward by a range of agencies. As a result of the practical availability and prevalence of private prosecutions and prosecutions by public bodies, other than the Crown Prosecution Service, this does justify control in certain cases of sensitivity by an explicit requirement for consent by the Attorney General. As explained, the situation does not arise in Scotland because all public prosecutions are brought by prosecutors within the system for which the Lord Advocate is responsible. The Lord Advocate's powers of legal direction, combined with his ministerial oversight of the system of prosecutions in Scotland, make it unnecessary, indeed constitutionally inappropriate, I would suggest, to prescribe the operational decision-making processes of the Crown in this way. And I know the Lord Advocate has made that entirely clear. Convener, I will speak to Amendment 6 in my name. Amendment 6 removes Section 4 from the Bill, which concerns the culpability of directors and presenters of plays where a performer commits an offence of stirring up hatred under Section 3 during the public performance of a play. This change has been welcomed by the committee in its Stage 1 report, and having listened carefully to the evidence during the scrutiny of the Bill, I decided that the provision does not serve a useful purpose in singling out directors and presenters of plays in a way that is not done for other similar categories. In particular, I consider there is no need to legislate that neglect could be sufficient to lead to criminal liability for a director or presenter of a play where a performer commits a stirring up hatred under Section 3. On that basis, I'm satisfied that the general criminal law rules on art and part liability can instead be applied to ensure that where any person commits a stirring up hatred offence under Section 3 of the Bill, and any other person who, for example, participates or assists with the committal of that stirring up offence may also be held criminally liable. I would ask members, therefore, to support Amendment 6. And then very finally, in this group, I turn to Amendment 8, also in my name, where an organisation has committed an offence under Section 3, or indeed Section 5 of the Bill, Section 9 makes provision for certain persons who are involved in the operation of organisations to be held criminally liable for committing an offence under Section 3 or 5. This is a normal feature of criminal law legislation. However, following further policy consideration since the introduction of the Bill, I consider that culpability of responsible individuals on the basis of neglect where an organisation commits an offence is too low a threshold in the context of offences relating to stirring up hatred. Accordingly, Amendments 8 remove neglect from the scope of the provision in Section 9. This amendment has the effect that Section 9 will apply only when an offence under Section 3 or 5 is committed by a relevant organisation and the commission of the offence involves consent or connivance on the part of a responsible individual. And with that, I remove Amendment 34 in my name.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for taking us through that so clearly and carefully. This is a long and complex group raising a large number of overlapping issues. I call Dean Lockhart now to move Amendment 34A and to speak to other amendments in the group. Dean.
Convener, my amendments in this grouping reflect representations the committee heard at Stage 1, in particular from the Law Society of Scotland. As currently drafted, the offence of stirring up racial hatred is provided for differently in the Bill compared to offences committed against other protected characteristics. Section 1A, whether this is amended by the Cabinet Secretary or not, will still retain the concept of insulting as a characteristic of behaviour which might lead to someone being considered to have committed an offence. The committee has heard a great deal of evidence on whether this element of the offence should remain part of the legislation, and my amendments provide the committee with an opportunity to consider this issue. One of the justifications given for retaining insulting conduct, as the Cabinet Secretary set out, is that the word is present in current legislation, the Public Order Act 1986, and has been in place for over 30 years. However, witnesses giving evidence to the committee were not convinced by this argument. For example, Dr. Andrew Tickell said that the argument that because this offence, this concept, is in the Public Order Act 1986 and therefore should be in the Bill is not convincing. We should be asking whether those protections, restrictions or extensions are necessary. In considering whether insulting is a necessary part of the Bill, Roddy Dunlop of the Faculty of Advocates thought not. He went on to say that it is difficult to see a situation in which words are used that are not threatening or abusive, yet might still be thought worthy of criminalisation under reference to insulting. In considering necessity, Mr. Dunlop also questioned how many convictions there have been on the basis of insulting and surmised, in his view, it was probably none or almost none. Therefore, he concluded he would not be concerned about dilution of protection if the word was removed from the legislation. Mr. Dunlop's view here is supported by assertions made by Anthony McGeachan of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, who told the committee that policy officials conducted a review of relevant cases in relation to the 1986 Public Order Act since 2009 and found that the removal of the words insulting would not diminish the ability of the Crown to take appropriate action in relation to those reported offences. All of this, Convener, indicates that there would be no weakening or dilution in the protection afforded by the legislation by removing the word insulting. However, on the other hand, including insulting would add, I think, further ambiguity to the bill and further ambiguity to the criminal law in Scotland. There is also the concern advanced by the Law Society of Scotland that retaining insulting could arguably create a hierarchy of victims. Anthony McGeachin also argued that there is a risk if the insulting offence is retained in the legislation in relation to racial hate crime, there is a risk that there would be a difference in the behaviour that is allowed in relation to other protected characteristics, but behaviour which is not allowed in relation to race crime. This was something that Police Scotland also alluded to, saying it could create a hierarchy of discrimination and make it more difficult for an officer to understand what types of behaviour and what circumstances cross the criminal threshold. We've heard concerns from the Cabinet Secretary that removing insulting from the draft legislation at this stage may send the wrong messaging, and that this is not a perception that the Scottish Government is willing to risk arising. However, in response to that concern, I would highlight the written evidence of Victim Support Scotland, which said the following: provided the exclusion of behaviour as insulting does not adversely impact anyone affected by crime, Victim Support Scotland can support this language change. If the Cabinet Secretary has a concern, I think, over messaging, then I think this can be addressed by making it clear that there has been no reduction in the underlying conduct which would constitute an offence under the bill. For these reasons, Convener, I think there's a strong case for the removal of the word insulting from the definition under the legislation. It does not weaken protection. It ensures that we will not inadvertently create a perceived hierarchy of offences, and it does not risk detriment. On that basis, I move the amendments in the grouping in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dean. Can I call Liam Kerr now, please, to speak to Amendment 39A and other amendments in the group? Liam.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I have a number of amendments in this group to speak to, and each seeks to address a very distinct shortcoming of the bill. I'm going to deal with my amendments slightly out of order, but it will become clear why. First of all, Amendment 17, which is the amendment to remove Section 3. Now, this is actually part of a series of amendments which will be debated in a later group, the combined impact of which is the deletion of Part 2, the stirring up offences. Now, it's been my contention from the start, as with a number of people actually, that Part 2 needed to be subject to great scrutiny, because whatever the drafting that we finally amend to at this stage too, these provisions will have significant and far-reaching ramifications. We consider them in a truncated timescale during circumstances which are far from ideal. This bill deals with extremely important issues, but Part 2 and its threat to free speech should be carved out in order that the other parts be amended as we are doing in these sessions, precisely so that we do not turn our backs on victims and, in fact, achieve precisely the opposite, as we all wish to. However, I do not think the committee will be with me on that, and I fear that should I press this and the later related amendments now, I'd be precluded from advancing the amendment and argument before full chamber at stage 3, and accordingly, I shall not be moving Amendment 17 today in order to preserve that position. Now, moving on to the removal of abuses. So these are Amendments 9, 10, 18, 25, 27, 39A and 40A, which seek to remove the term abusive from the stirring up hatred provisions and thus limit the scope to threatening behaviour. Now, at the outset, this would bring these provisions into line with public order laws south of the border on the stirring up of hatred on grounds of religion and sexual orientation. Those laws, which have been in place for over a decade, have struck a balance between preventing the stirring up of hatred and protecting freedom of expression. Now, that would suggest that threatening behaviour is an appropriate threshold to adopt and does not go beyond what is required to protect what is required to be protected. It is certainly clear, catching as it does words and behaviour that intimate violence. In contrast, abusive arguably risks reducing the threshold for what could be considered hate speech and could thus be used to try to shut down the expression of opinions. Because bear in mind, as drafted, these terms are to be read disjunctively, threatening or abusive, not conjunctively. The Cabinet Secretary has acknowledged, indeed, that there is a problem with the abusive limb by tabling his amendments to add a reasonable person test. Now, that is welcome as far as it goes, and is the reason, incidentally, I shall support his amendments in this regard and not press my amendments 42 and 45. But those amendments don't go far enough. Some stakeholders have rightly asked, will these proposals catch speech and writing that is not currently criminal? That speech and writing that is controversial, combative, even insulting, but which ought rightly to be protected as part of our democratic tradition. The Lord Justice Sedley famously said that free speech includes not only the inoffensive, but the irritating, the contentious, the eccentric, the heretical, the unwelcome, the provocative. It's such an important point. The freedom to speak one's mind should not be restricted by other people's dislike of your views. We should all operate with a presumption in favour of free speech and be willing to defend other people's freedom to speak, even when we profoundly disagree with what they're saying. Now, this is a concern that's been raised by many different contributors to the consultation from many different perspectives, that the term abusive could lead to merely contentious or provocative speech being caught by these offences. And my concern, convener, is particularly at the front end of this process, what kind of reports could be lodged with Police Scotland should the stirring up hatred provisions leave any room for doubt on what abusive is taken to mean? And if that case proceeds, the courts would have to adjudicate on whether someone's political opinions were abusive. Accordingly, my amendments listen to those who contributed to the consultation and our evidence sessions who are concerned that, yes, a reasonable person test is useful, as amended in by the Cabinet Secretary, but also wish to see the uncertainty inherent even in that test removed. My amendments would remove that uncertainty, and I therefore move them. Turning, convener, to another set of amendments that I've lodged, the amendments 41, 44 and 84. These are what I'll call throughout colloquially the dwelling defence. They seek to provide a defence for words spoken in a private dwelling and which are not overheard by another person except those within. Now, I note again at the outset that a provision of this kind exists in parallel public order laws in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. But the underlying rationale for what I'm trying to do here is twofold. Firstly, a point which was made several times during the committee session, I think including by yourself, convener, it reflects the fact that this legislation is supposed to be concerned with public disorder, as demonstrated by the title of the bill itself. We can all recognise the risk of public disorder at a rally where feelings are inflamed by rabble-rousing public speakers and where individuals can feel emboldened by being in a large group to commit criminal acts. But the same considerations do not apply in the context of a private family home. The language remains equally reprehensible, if you like, at the public rally, but the risk of public disorder is clearly not present. Secondly, there's a wider argument for protecting private speech in the context of the home. Throughout the debate on these proposals, the committee has recognised there is an inevitable tension between, but also the need to balance, the tackling of hate crime with the vital rights of freedom of speech and expression. The government has been forced into making concessions throughout this whole process precisely because the bill, as drafted, failed to protect our right to freedom of speech. But the lack of a private dwelling exemption is one where no concession has yet been made, but it needs to be. Allowing prosecution for stirring up over private conversations in your own home is a violation of privacy. Crucially, a dwelling defence would not hinder the operation of that offence. Indeed, Lord Bracadale told our committee that, quote, no suggestion has been made to me that the existence of an exception, a dwelling defence exception, has inhibited the use of the stirring up provision. Now, during the evidence sessions, the committee heard concerns that allegations could be made by individuals after an argument at a dinner party or a similar social event and investigated by the police. It's difficult to establish a case for stirring up hatred offence having been committed in that scenario. And Callum Steele, of the Scottish Police Federation also warned us that conversations on contentious issues could be repeated innocently by children in the playground and lead to reporting. The police would have no choice but to investigate, and in building a case for prosecution, they'd have to take witness statements from the others present. Imagine the scenario where if you had a guest in your family home who took objection to something you said, the only other witnesses might be your spouse, your children. Without a dwelling defence, this bill could lead to a ridiculous scenario where parents are censoring themselves in their own homes because they are anxious their children might repeat something they've said out of context. The idea that we are going to empower the police to question children over what a parent said over the dinner table is surely anathema to our democratic values. In summary, convener, I think the reason for much of the opposition to part two is that it deals with situations in which people have opinions. We may not like them. We may not agree with them, but people have a right to them, and they surely must have a right to express them in their own home. It cannot be the job of the police to investigate private ideological disputes and to use the criminal law to set the parameters of acceptable opinion. I fear it would cause serious harm to the police's reputation with the public if they were forced to investigate things said in the privacy of your own home. And I therefore move and seek support for my amendments 41, 44 and 84. Finally, for me in this group, convener, Amendment 55 stipulates that any decision to take proceedings on a stirring up hatred defence must require the consent of Crown Counsel. This is what I'll refer to colloquially, if you like, as a prosecution lock for ease. Now, both the Public Order Act of 1986 and the Public Order Northern Ireland Order 1987 require a similar step before prosecutions are brought. The relevant consideration I have in mind here is that, for reasons I've looked at in earlier amendments, there is a danger one could be accused of stirring up offence and taken through a prosecution simply for speaking an offensive viewpoint. Even if one is not ultimately guilty of the offence, to be accused of such an offence has the potential to ruin someone's life, particularly if they were taken through the court system first. Now, the Cabinet Secretary has spoken persuasively as to the incorporation of a reasonable person test at Amendment 40. And really what I seek to do here is to ensure that that consideration is made at a preliminary stage. Now, in England, consent for a stirring up prosecution is required from the Attorney General. In Northern Ireland, it's the Director of Public Prosecutions. Here, the equivalent level of seniority would be the Lord Advocate, but as both the Lord Advocate and the Cabinet Secretary have set out, we have no legislative precedent for sending such decisions to the very top of the prosecution hierarchy in that way, which is precisely why I have not gone for that. Instead, I've based this amendment on guidance issued by the Lord Advocate in 2013. That guidance says, and I quote, "Any decision to take proceedings in relation to cases of this nature will be approved by Crown Counsel." So clearly, sign-off by Crown Counsel is a mechanism which we do have precedent for here in Scotland. Now, given the enormous public concern about these new stirring up hatred defences, this is a simple additional check and balance that we can add to the legislation to help reassure people that prosecutions will only be brought when all the issues, including the importance of free speech, have been properly considered by a senior prosecutor. Now, this committee all received a letter from the Lord Advocate last week addressing itself specifically to this amendment. And first, let me acknowledge my gratitude to the Lord Advocate for taking the time to address this specific point. His argument is, of course, persuasive, but I do not think it is compelling reason to reject my amendment. The Lord Advocate is, of course, correct that we operate a completely different justice system to that which is developed in England and Wales. He cites this as a reason why he does not find favour for my argument that other jurisdictions do it, so why not Scotland? But I do not find it persuasive as a reason to reject the principle of a prosecution lock. In my submission, the principle is sound, and that principle is not defeated by comparison. The Lord Advocate then contends that a prosecution lock is wholly unnecessary, as the Lord Advocate would put in place appropriate policies and procedures for decision making, including whether a case should be reported to Crown Counsel. No doubt. And were such policies in place, the amendment would be otiose. But there are no such policies and procedures in place. And that means
There is no such prosecutorial lock or safeguard in the event of a passage of this bill to prevent such a prosecution, and there should be. The Lord Advocate's letter makes his next argument for not incorporating a prosecutorial lock, that one of the reasons for having a prosecutorial lock in England is because individuals there can bring private prosecutions, which is not possible in Scotland. But I don't follow the logic of that point. I'm not concerned with people bringing private prosecutions. I'm worried that by handing fiscals the difficult decision of having to implement a contentious new law, they will have to make those difficult decisions in a vacuum. So an extra safeguard is absolutely justified. Now, I completely understand why members might understand the principle behind my amendment, but be reluctant to accept it following the Lord Advocate's letter. However, I've set out clearly my submission, why my submission should be preferred and why the amendment should be agreed to. So at this stage, I am minded to move the amendment pending listening to what the Cabinet Secretary has to say in response to my remarks when he concludes. But for the avoidance of doubt, I'm all too aware that should I press this amendment at stage two, I may be disbarred from bringing a revised amendment on the same principle at stage three. Kavina, whilst I therefore move my amendment at this stage, as I'm very keen to hear the debate on this, I reserve the right not to press when you ask me the question in order to preserve my position at stage three. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kerr. That's very clear and helpful. John Finney has indicated that he wants to say a few words in this debate, and then after John Finney, I want to say something myself. John.
Thank you, Convener, and I thank those that have, for their contributions, who have proposed amendments. Excuse me. I want to talk about a couple of positives, first, if I may, Convener, and that is in relation to Amendment 6, please. I welcome the positive response to the Scottish Government that it was always seen as being an outrider there. A lot of people simply couldn't understand why it was in the legislation. And I welcome its removal, not least because the one thing that we want in Scotland and any progressive liberal democracy is a vibrant art sector, and that sends a very clear message. So I welcome that. Similarly, on Amendment 8 with the threshold of stirring up, I think again that's helpful, and I'm glad that there's been a positive response to the committee's stage one report. The objective definition being applied to the meaning of the term abusive, I think has to be welcomed by everyone. That's we want some clarity, and I'm going to come to prosecutorial policy in a wee while, but I have to say there's nothing new in this bill. In fact, I'll just do it now. There's nothing new in this bill about how the police would engage with the public, how the police would respond to crimes or accusations of crimes, how the prosecution would treat things differently. There's nothing new in here about this. And I have to say, some of Liam Kerr's hyperbole is bordering on nonsense, quite frankly. I want to also, alluding to the briefing we've all had from the Equality Network, who asked us to reject Amendments 39A, 9, 40A, 10, 18, 25 and 27, which would remove abusive from stirring up hatred offences from protected characteristics other than race. Now, we know that the government amendments will ensure abusive is interpreted objectively. And I'm quoting from that briefing here, hate crime legislation is intended to combat the genuine harm caused to affected communities by behaviours covered in the law. Restricting the coverage of the offence only to the behaviour that is threatening would narrow the scope of excluded behaviours and cause as much or more harm than directly threatening. Now, Convener, you'll recall the compelling evidence we've had from a range of people, and one of the comments that came at the time from the Equality Network was, and their overall evidence was when they talked about the grossly abusive graphic material produced about Jewish people by the Nazis, illustrations, and how that illustrated that the intention of stirring up hatred can be done by material that it's not in itself explicitly threatening. I also somewhat bemused that what we have is a situation where going on to ridicule what the Lord Advocate says at some point, Mr. Kerr tells us that the Lord Advocate made persuasive arguments. I certainly thought they were persuasive in relation to Mr. Kerr wanting to rewrite prosecutorial policy in Scotland. Moving to the situation of the Amendment 17, which would delete the stirring up offence entirely, including race. Now, I note that Mr. Kerr wants to preserve his position on that. When it comes to Mr. Kerr being asked about that, if Mr. Kerr doesn't wish to press that amendment, I will wish to press it on his behalf, and let's get this nonsense dealt with at stage two rather than this preserving his position. And I'll do that in respect of his other amendments as well. This is pandering. If we are going to address the perniciousness of hate crime across the United Kingdom, we need a uniform approach. We need our laws to be as closely, and good grief, I would have thought that's something a Conservative member would have be speaking about. We need cooperation. We need international cooperation on this. This is taking a wrecking ball, not just to this bill, but to existing protections. That's simply unacceptable. I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, John. Fulton McGregor and Rhoda Grant also want to come in this debate, but perhaps I could just say a few words before I turn to Fulton. There's a lot in this group, and I want to say a few words about a number of different themes that have arisen in relation to the amendments in this group. And I want to start with the amendments that I have supported that are in the Cabinet Secretary's name that define abusive in an objective way. For me, this is a question of absolutely fundamental principle, to the point where I would not have been able to support this bill unless an amendment like this was made. We spoke last week, we had a debate last week about freedom of speech and about freedom of expression clauses in this bill. For me, those clauses are, of course, important, and it is imperative that we get them right at stage three. But even more important than getting them right at stage three is having an appropriately narrow, curtailed and defined scope of the offences that we are writing into the Scots Criminal Lawbook, and explaining what we mean by the terms that we use, especially when those terms are apt to be stretched and used in different ways by different interested parties, is critical. And it's critical to the exercise of good lawmaking. And the committee, I think, was unanimous in its stage one report in concluding that abusive needed to be defined objectively. In the stage one debate, there was some discussion about whether that needed to be done on the face of the bill or simply in explanatory notes or in guidance. And I'm absolutely delighted that the Cabinet Secretary has seen the force of the argument, which I, as he said, tried to put myself, that abusive needed to be objectively defined on the face of the bill. And that's why I support that suite of amendments that does that. I think those are matters of fundamental principle that go to the very heart of the balance that we're seeking to strike between criminalising that which stirs up hatred and at the same time seeking to safeguard and protect freedom of expression. I don't support the amendments that have been put in the name of Liam Kerr to remove abusive from the bill. I would have supported them if abusive had not been defined objectively and clearly. But it's much more important to me, it's much more important, it seems to me, that we have a clear and objective understanding of what abusive means. And if the amendments in the Cabinet Secretary's name are supported, then by the committee, as I believe they will be, then I see no case for removing abusive from the scope of the criminal law in this context. At all, not least because there are a number of other areas unrelated to hate crime where abuse or abusiveness is criminalised, not least, of course, in the Domestic Abuse Act that this Parliament passed a couple of years ago. So that is, for me, a question of fundamental principle. What are not questions of fundamental principle, but are much more finely balanced questions of judgment, are the debates about whether the word insulting should remain in the scope of the racial hatred offences, and the extent to which there needs to be a public element or a public facing element in these offences. With regard to both of these issues, I find the arguments very finely balanced indeed, and indeed so did the committee in its stage one report. The committee recognised the force of the arguments both for removing insulting from the scope of the racial hatred offences and for not doing so, those arguments being put by different witnesses who kindly gave evidence to us. I find this a difficult one to wrestle with, but I have concluded that for myself, I think that insulting should be removed from the scope of the offences with regard to racial hatred for two reasons. First, because of the definition of race in this bill, which is not just about race, it's also about ethnicity, citizenship, and nationality. And I'm not sure that we should be criminalising people who insult each other on the basis of their nationality or citizenship. I don't see why nationality and citizenship should be protected more fully in our criminal law than transgender identity or sexual orientation. And secondly, because where an issue is very finely balanced and there are good, sound arguments going in both directions, it seems to me that the freedom of expression considerations, which underpin all of this, should tilt that balance in favour of the outcome, which is more protective of free speech. That seems to me the force of the way in which the committee wrote about freedom of expression in its stage one report, where we said, I think, that freedom of expression is a general principle that should be broadly and amply interpreted and understood, and exceptions to that principle should be as narrowly drawn as possible. So for those reasons, and I don't think this is a question that goes to the kind of fundament of this bill, I don't think this is a fundamental question of principle, but I think it's a very finely balanced question of judgment, I will support the amendments, which I think are largely in Dean Lockhart's name, that seek to remove the word insulting from the scope of the racial hatred offences. And similar reasons lead me to conclude that I will support the amendments in Mr. Kerr's name that reintroduce into our public order law a public-facing element of these offences. Here it's not freedom of expression so much as the right to privacy, which is at issue. Again, I think these are finely balanced issues. I think there are plausible and sound arguments going in both directions, but on balance, I find myself in sympathy with what Mr. Kerr has had to say about that. Two final points from me before I bring in Mr. McGregor and Rhoda Grant, who are waiting very patiently. I completely agree and find both persuasive and compelling what the Lord Advocate has had to say about the so-called prosecution lock. This is an issue on which the committee did not take any oral evidence in our stage one inquiry. It's an issue on which the committee did not express a strong view in its stage one report. It's an issue which pertains in the prosecutorial systems of England and Northern Ireland because of the different offices that they have in their prosecution systems that we don't have in Scotland, and for the reasons that the Lord Advocate has amply set out in his lengthy letter to the committee last week, for which I thank him, it's clear that that kind of prosecution lock does not fit within the fabric of the Scottish criminal justice system, and so I won't be supporting Mr. Kerr's amendment in that regard. And the final thing I'd like to say is just that I support and I'm very pleased to support the amendments that remove from this bill sections 4 and 5. And that is what I want to say to this group. Thank you for your patience, Fulton, and it's now over to you.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks for bringing me in. I'll be quite brief. I just want to make a few remarks on the veiling offence amendments that have been brought forward by Liam Kerr, because there was quite a lot of discussion around this area in committee. And I have to say that although Liam's put forward an argument here, I just can't agree with it. And I feel that, you know, these sort of amendments to introduce a dwelling defence, you know, could take us back many years. And I say that because if you look at situations like domestic violence, you know, it wouldn't have been so far long ago that people maybe would have turned up to committees like this, not to this parliament, because, you know, it was only re-established more recently, but in other places of power, and argued that, you know, these are things for behind closed doors. And, you know, I think we can all agree here in the various, you know, cases that we get in cross-party groups in this party, that some of the worst offences actually happen behind closed doors, to use that quote. And I know that Liam Kerr, as I said, puts forward a reasonable argument that might sound quite justifiable, you know, if you're just tuning into it and listening and thinking, oh, well, that sounds right, quite reasonable. But you know, I don't actually think it holds up to the scrutiny that we heard. You know, we've already established certain thresholds. We know that this bill doesn't, you know, prosecute free speech, that it will offer protection for people to have free speech. So it's not about, you know, people aren't going to be prosecuted for, you know, things which aren't hate crimes. But, you know, at the end of the day, if it's a public space or a private space and it's a hate crime, surely we agree if there's evidence there, it should be prosecuted. And I know that the example that Liam Kerr used was, you know, a family sitting at the dinner table and they're worried about, you know, what the kids might say. Well, my argument to that would be, if a hate crime's been committed in front of the kids, then, or the partner, then a hate crime's been committed. And if it's not, it's not. And that's quite simple. And surely we should all want, you know, any kids not to be exposed to any hate crime. And I know that the main argument would be, well, it's the orders, you know, the public aspect of it. I know you picked up on that as well, Convener. I think that probably is the strongest point on this, but surely if the worry is that then the issue's taken out of the home, then it becomes public anyway. So if the kids, and to use Liam Kerr's example, then go and repeat what's been said by presumably the parent in the private dwelling, then that is in the public interest if that hate crime is then taken elsewhere. So, you know, I they were the only amendments I wanted to speak on, and I won't be supporting Liam Kerr's amendments on those issues. And thanks for the time, convener, to delay that.
Thank you very much. Could I ask Rhonda Grant to contribute to this debate, please? Rhonda.
Thank you, convener, and I will be as quick as I can, but this is probably the most contentious part of the bill and it will be amended today. It'll be interesting to see if that meets the aspirations of those who had concerns about it. I welcome the reasonable person interpretation. I think that goes a long way to meet concerns and I'll certainly be supporting that. On the removal of insulting, the balance is fine, but it seems to me to be between whether it adds or takes away anything. And in my view, to be seen to water down protections in a hate crime bill would not be the right direction to take. So I will not be voting in for Amendment 34A or 35. With regard to the private dwelling defence, I have some sympathy for what it is trying to do. But when we're talking about threatening or abusive behaviour and that not to be prosecuted if it takes place in a private dwelling, I don't think that hits the right balance at all. So it would be okay for you to go into someone's house, say, and be threatened and abused, but not be able to report that as a crime because that defence is there. And that is even more so with the use of social media. If you were carrying out that threatening and abusive behaviour on your Twitter account or something like that, that surely has to not be defendable because it took place in a private dwelling. So that's really all I want to say, and obviously reserve my position on this section for stage three, because we need to meet the aspirations of those who have real concerns about it. I hope the amendments I'll be supporting will go some way to do that.
Thank you, Rhoda. No other member has indicated that they wish to contribute to the debate in this group. So could I invite the Cabinet Secretary to wind up on Amendment 34, and then I'll ask Dean Lockhart to formally wind up on the group and to press or withdraw Amendment 34A. The Cabinet Secretary first, please.
If I may, Camilla, thank you very much, speak to some of the points that have been raised. This has been a really useful and helpful debate and shows that we can, I think, debate these issues that are at times highly contentious, but with, I would hope, a degree of respect. If I can maybe just reference some of the remarks that have been made in relation to Dean Lockhart's amendment around insulting. He suggested that they would only or simply be a perception that there was a weakening of the law, that actually in practice removing insulting as part of the threshold in relation to racial hatred wouldn't actually materially make a difference. And I think I would say back to Christine Lockhart, that particularly in this bill, I think we have all agreed that perceptions can be important. We accept that when we discuss freedom of expression clauses, for example, as we did collectively as a committee alongside with government yesterday. I think the vast majority of us probably accept that it would make little material difference to the bill having a freedom of expression clause, but we also accept that it gives assurance to a number of people concerned about the impact of the bill in relation to free speech. So I think perceptions are hugely important. But I would also say that Dean Lockhart referenced a number of stakeholders that he spoke to and quoted them in relation to the insulting threshold. But I noted that he didn't mention any or not a single racial equality stakeholder. And I hope that when suggesting such a change, he would have spoken to them, and he may have done. And of course, he can tell us such in his summing up. But I would remind him of that really important maxim that I hope we all agree on: what is about us without us is not for us. And therefore, it would be imperative, I think, we take into consideration the views of those that would be most affected by any potential, at least perception, of the weakening of the law. Kavina, you and your support of the remove, and I note everything you said about that being a finely balanced decision. I would come back to say that we are not criminalising people who are insulting people due to their nationality. They would also have to have either the intention of stirring up hatred, or indeed the behaviour or material communicated would likely to be likely to stir up hatred. And when we talk about nationality, you know, if people were insulting people who were Polish or Pakistani with the intention of stirring up hatred, or indeed that their behaviour was likely to stir up hatred, then I think most of us would agree that should be prosecuted. I would also add, of course, the point that this insulting threshold has existed since 1986, for almost 35 years without any controversy. And I'm curious to these amendments where they're trying to fix a problem that I do not think exists. In addition to Liam Kerr's amendments to the public element that have been spoken about, again, I accept for a number of members, there is a kind of finely balanced judgment in this regard, and I want to give members a reassurance that I haven't dismissed any of those arguments that call for a dwelling defence or a public element. Far from it. I've given it very serious consideration and quite a few sleepless nights thinking about this issue. And I know that often at stage two, when we debate amendments, as we have done already, we do so on technicalities, on draftsmanship. However, on these amendments in relation to a public element, that is firmly a matter of principle and firmly a matter of policy. You should ask those who have been victims of hate crime, assaulted due to their colour of skin, their religion, beaten up because they're gay, ask them whether they are comforted by the fact that the individual who stirred up hatred against them cannot be prosecuted because they did so in their own home. I think they will receive no comfort from that fact whatsoever. There are serious flaws with these amendments in relation to the public element. Somebody could have 20 friends in their private dwelling. The windows, the curtains could be closed, the doors could be locked. And they could intentionally stir up hatred against people who are Jewish. For example, those 20 individuals then go out and desecrate synagogues, graffiti them with swastikas, and they of course would be charged for those offences. But the individual who stirred up hatred and intended to stir up hatred against Jewish people would not be prosecuted. How in any way can that be justified or be seen to be fair? Let's give another example. You could have workmen in your house, a group of workmen doing work in your house. One of them may be Polish, for example, and therefore you stir up hatred with the other workmen in that house. They assault, they attack, they verbally abuse that one workman in your house. But because it was done in your private dwelling, then you cannot be prosecuted for stirring up hatred. That, to me, cannot be right. So I will not add anything else to any of the other amendments, other than to say I firmly agree with the points made by Lord Advocate, as you'd imagine. I would, and I hope that members will support the amendments in my name and reject those that I have, and the government has expressed some serious reservation and opposition to.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And now I invite Dean Lockhart formally to wind up. Professor, withdraw Amendment 34A.
Thank you very much, Convener, and I will press my Amendment 34A. I will make this very brief as well, because I think the committee members have done a very good job in explaining the underlying rationale behind some of the amendments and their concerns about some of the other amendments not being pressed. With respect to insulting, I do understand the Cabinet Secretary's concerns about perception and the concern he has if the language and the concept is dropped at this stage in the legislation. But as the committee has heard in evidence, this is something that can be dealt with by the Scottish Government. And that concern, in my view, is outweighed by the serious concerns that would arise if the concept of insulting is retained in the legislation. I won't go through all the concerns I highlighted in my opening remarks, but the creation of uncertainty in Scottish criminal law by retaining this, I think, would be unwelcome. We've heard from Police Scotland that it would be difficult to police in practice through the creation of a hierarchy of events where some behaviour in respect of some protected characteristics is allowed and some behaviour in respect of other protected characteristics is not allowed. So that is something I think is a serious concern. And on that basis, Convener, I will move and press Amendment 34A in my name.
Thank you very much, Dean. So the question is that Amendment 34A be agreed to. Are we all agreed? If we're not agreed, there will be a division. So can I ask that all those members of the committee in favour of Amendment 34A please type Y into the chat box now. All those members of the committee opposed to Amendment 34A, please type N into the chat box now. And any member of the committee abstaining on Amendment 34A, please type A into the chat box now. There were two votes in favour and seven votes against. The amendment is disagreed. Those voting in favour were Adam Tomkins and Liam Kerr. Those voting against were Rona Mackay, Annabel Ewing, Shirley Robertson, Fulton McGregor, Rhoda Grant, Ian MacArthur and John Finney. So the amendment is disagreed. Cabinet Secretary, to press or withdraw Amendment 34.
I move press Amendment.
Thank you. That is pressed. The question is that Amendment 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I cannot call Amendment 35 because it's preempted by Amendment 34. So I call Amendment 36 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 34. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved, Peter.
And I remind members that if Amendment 36 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 37. I call Amendment 36A and then in the name of Dean Lockhart, already debated with Amendment 34. Dean Lockhart to move or not move.
Moved, Convener.
That's moved. So the question is that Amendment 36A be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There will be division. So can I ask all members of the committee in favour of Amendment 36A to type Y into the chat box now, please? All members of the committee who disagree with Amendment 36A to vote N into the chat box now, please. There were two votes in favour, there were seven votes against. Those who voted in favour were Adam Tomkins and Liam Kerr. Those who voted against were Rona Mackay, Annabel Ewing, Shirley Robertson, Fulton McGregor, Rhoda Grant, Liam MacArthur and John Finney. So the amendment 36A is disagreed. Cabinet Secretary to press or withdraw Amendment 36.
Press, move and my name.
The question is that Amendment 36 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Because Amendment 36 is agreed, I cannot call Amendment 37. So I call Amendment 38 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 34. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
That moved, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 38 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 39 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 34. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. I remind members that if Amendment 39 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 9. I call Amendment 39A in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 34. Liam Kerr to move or not move?
Moved.
That is moved. The question is that Amendment 39A be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There will be division on Amendment 39A. All those members of the committee in favour of Amendment 39A to type Y into the chat box now. All those members of the committee opposed to Amendment 39A to type N into the chat box now. And any member abstaining, type A into the chat box now. There was one vote in favour, there were 8 votes against. Those voting in favour were Liam Kerr, and those voting against were Rona Mackay, Annabel Ewing, Shirley Robertson, Fulton McGregor, Adam Tompkins, Rhoda Grant, Liam MacArthur and John Finney. So Amendment 39A is not agreed. Cabinet Secretary to press or withdraw Amendment 39.
Moved, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call amendment, sorry, I'm just over a page here. Amendment 39 agreed to, go straight to amendment 40. Sorry, can we just pause for a minute, please? I need to take a word of advice from the clerk. Can the clerk call me, please, on my phone? Sorry about that. I just needed to check something that I couldn't understand. Because Amendment 39 was agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 9. So I call Amendment 40 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 34. Cabinet Secretary to move or not move?
Moved.
And I remind members that if Amendment 40 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 10. I call Amendment 40A in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 34. Liam Kerr to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. So the question is that Amendment 40A be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There will be a division on Amendment 40A. But can all those members of the committee in favour of Amendment 40A please type Y into the chat box now? All those members of the committee opposed to Amendment 40A please type N into the chat. The result of Amendment 40A is that there was one vote in favour, there were 8 votes against. Those voting in favour were Liam Kerr. Those voting against were Rona Mackay, Annabel Ewing, Shona Robertson, Fulton McGregor, Adam Tompkins, Rhoda Grant, Liam MacArthur and John Finney. So Amendment 40A is disagreed. The Cabinet Secretary to press or withdraw Amendment 40.
I press it.
The question is that Amendment 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. And as Amendment 40 has been agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 10. So I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 34. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 1 be agreed. Are we agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 34. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. I'm going to suspend the meeting for 5 minutes just to enable everybody to take a comfort break, check on their children and all of that sort of thing. So we will reconvene just after 11:35. Meeting is suspended. Yeah.
I'm good, yeah.
Okay. Okay, thanks everyone, welcome back. We now move to the next group, which is on stirring up hatred offence characteristics. And I call Amendment 11 in the name of Liam Kerr, grouped with Amendments 12, 13, 14, 15, and 16. Liam Kerr to move Amendment 11 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, the probing amendments that I've laid at 11 through to 16 are about seeking clarity and flushing out the evidence base that perhaps due to the truncated timetable to which this bill is operating, the Cabinet Secretary has been unable to provide prior to this point. Underlying this request is the way that the bill has been drafted. It doesn't seem to create a single unified criminal offence of stirring up hatred. Rather, it looks to particularise in section 3.3 six protected characteristics and then establish offences spinning off each of those. However, this committee being asked to consider the characteristics as a package and to include all of them. The arguments put forward for doing so by the government and by Lord Bracadale have focused, I think, on the symbolism of this approach rather than the practicalities of it. So my amendments simply probe the Cabinet Secretary to provide for each of the protected characteristics the evidential basis for introducing each one in section 3.3. And within his answer, can he set out for each protected characteristic the Scottish Government's estimate of how many cases it expects to proceed before court for each characteristic? And finally, can he point for each characteristic to a specific case where he thinks the police might not be able to currently act in relation to that specific characteristic? Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. No other member has indicated that they wish to speak in this group. One other member has now indicated that he wishes to speak in this group. So can I call John Finney, please?
Forgive me, Convener, I was a bit slow with the keyboard there. These are important amendments, and it's important that we discuss these. Once again, I find myself looking to the briefings we've had, and particularly the one from the Equality Network that says, and again, quote, I think it's important to quote for people directly on the front line here, amendments 14, 15, and 16 would be a stark statement that the Parliament believes that LGBTI people are less valuable than other people covered by this bill. And they go on to say this would represent a reversal of many decades of progress in Scotland. I wholeheartedly agree with that and won't be supporting Mr. Kerr's amendments, and will press them. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Finney. No other member has indicated they wish to take part, Mr. Bates, so can I call the Cabinet Secretary, please?
Convener, I can be relatively brief. I share much of the sentiment. And possibly even some degree of anger, actually, at these amendments coming forward. I associate myself with remarks on the Equality Network and others who will ask if these protections are not extended to them in the way they currently exist for those in relation to racial stirring up offences, then do they feel that they are not as adequately protected in the law? Does that mean that they are lesser in terms of the hatred that is directed towards them? That would be a dangerous signal for any parliament to send, let alone our own. We know, for example, in England and Wales, stirring up offences have been extended to cover religion and sexual orientation. We also know in Northern Ireland there are stirring up of hatred offences that cover race, religion, sexual orientation and disability. As we know, has been described already in section 3.1 of the bill, it provides for the offence of stirring up hatred in relation to race. Amendments 11 to 16 seek to remove each of the additional characteristics which the new offence of stirring up hatred in sections 3-2 of the bill relate. Liam Kerr asks a whole range of questions around an evidential base. I'm happy to write to him with more detail of that. But he should, I would have hoped, have been comforted by the evidence that he heard when he was as a member of the Justice Committee during stage one of the oral evidence. Liam Kerr often talks about a truncated timetable, and I do accept, of course, the committee has quite a lot currently to deal with in a truncated period of time, particularly given COVID pressures. But the committee took almost 40 oral evidence representations during its stage one oral evidence proceeding. So it cannot claim, or no member can claim, to have not heard these issues debated to some length. The effects of amendments 11 to 16 would remove, depending on if they're agreed, of course, could remove some or all of the listed protected characteristics from the scope of the stirring up hatred offences. This could mean that perpetrators who deliberately tend to stir up hatred based on, say, a person's sexual orientation or disability would not face criminal sanction in relation to the distinct harm that is caused by such behaviour. If there is a particular characteristic, and Liam Kerr did not seem to suggest there was, but if there is a particular characteristic that is making that is giving cause for concern to Liam Kerr, I'd be interested to hear what that characteristic is. Should he single it out? And therefore, of course, I could give him particular data that he may wish to see. I've often said that stirring up of hatred offences, I do not and would not expect them to be prosecuted in large number. Even the racial stirring up offence that we know that has existed for almost 35 years in the last decade has only been prosecuted in Scotland 7 or 8 times. So we know that it would not be prosecuted a large number of times. We certainly know that any time it has been prosecuted, of course, can make a very stark and important difference to the communities that have been targeted. So, convener, I cannot support these amendments, which at best would result in some characteristics being favoured over others to benefit from the protections afforded under Section 3-2 of the bill, and at worst it could remove those protections entirely. I leave you with the question that if I am protected due to my race in terms of not having hatred stirred up against me, then why should others who are often the victims of hate not be afforded that very same protection? Legislating to protect all existing and new characteristics from offences of stirring up hatred, as the bill currently does, will send a very important message, a very important signal that this type of behaviour attracts particular condemnation by society and it will not tolerate it. But it is more than just a message. It is about the law affording those protections to groups that are often susceptible to hatred. To do any less than that would fail victims of hate crime. So I therefore urge members to vote against amendments 11 to 16.
Thank you. I see Rhoda Grant has just indicated that she wishes to contribute, but I think I can squeeze you in, Rhoda, but it's a very late call if you're brief.
It's very, very brief. I won't be voting for any of those amendments, and indeed characteristic added to the list, and that's that of sex.
Thank you. That was commendably brief. Thank you very much. Liam Kerr, to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 11, please.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I'm grateful for the contributions, but disappointed, as I have been throughout, by Mr. Finney's approach to this. It is the job of Parliament to ensure matters such as these are explored. And if there is a lacuna in the government's evidence base, which stakeholders are interested in hearing about, then probing amendments such as these are a legitimate mechanism to test that, to explore that. So, Convener, I won't be pressing these. If John Finney wishes to do so, then let the record show he was the one who wished to remove these characteristics. I do not move Amendment 11.
Amendment 11 has already been moved, but you do not wish to press it. So is the committee correct that Amendment 11 is withdrawn? The question, Mr. Finney. Can I call John Finney, please?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, no, I think it's important if we engage in discussions in a present the characteristic, of course, we must have robust scrutiny and encourage that all the way along. I would like to press that amendment, please.
So that amendment is pressed. The question is that Amendment 11 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. So can I ask members of the committee who are in favour of Amendment 11 to type Y into the chat box now, please? Members of the committee who are opposed to Amendment 11 to type N into the chat box now, please? And any member of the committee abstaining on Amendment 11 to type A into the chat box now, please? The result on Amendment 11 is that there were no votes in favour and 9 votes against. All members of the committee voted against the amendment. I call Amendment 12 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 11. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Not move.
That's not moved. I call Amendment 13 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 11. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Not moved.
That's not moved. I call Amendment 14 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 11. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Not moved.
And I call Amendment 15 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 11. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 16 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 11. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 41 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 34. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. The question is that Amendment 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. There will be division on Amendment 41. So can I ask all those members of the committee in favour of Amendment 41 to type Y into the chat box now, please? And can I ask all members of the committee opposed to Amendment 41 to type N into the chat box now, please? And any member of the committee abstaining on Amendment 41, type A into the chat box, please. The result on Amendment 41 is that there were 2 votes in favour and 7 votes against. The amendment is not agreed. Those voting in favour were Adam Tomkins and Liam Kerr. Those voting against were Rona Mackay, Annabel Ewing, Shona Robeson, Fulton McGregor, Rhoda Grant, Liam MacArthur and John Finney. I call Amendment 42 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 34. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Not move.
That's not moved. I call Amendment 17 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 34. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call John Finney. Can somebody unmute John Finney, please? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to move Amendment 17 in Mr. Kerr's name, so as I can vote against it.
Thank you, Mr. Finney, the question is that Amendment 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed, so there will be a division on Amendment 17. All those in favour of Amendment 17, please vote. Please type Y into the chat box now. All those opposed to Amendment 17, please type N into the chat box now. And any member abstaining on Amendment 17, please type A into the chat box now. The result of Amendment 17 is that there were no votes in favour and 9 votes against. There were no abstentions, so all members of the committee voted against Amendment 17. I call Amendment 6 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 34. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Move, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That's moved. The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 18 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 34. Liam Kerr to move or not move?
Of a debate that's shortly to arrive, convener, not moved.
That's not moved. I call Amendment 3 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 34. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Move, convener.
Thank you, that's moved. The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 4 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 34. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Move, convener.
Thank you, that's moved. The question is that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 43 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, already debated with Amendment 30. Liam Kerr to move or not move?
The member has asked me to not move that amendment.
That's not moved. Thank you. I call Amendment 44 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 34. Liam Kerr to move or not move?
In anticipation of Amendment 19 being debated, not moved.
That's not moved. Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I call Amendment 45 in the name of Liam Kerr, already debated with Amendment 34. Liam Kerr to move or not move?
In anticipation of Amendment 19 being debated, not moved.
That's not moved. Thank you, Mr. Kerr. So we move to the next group, which is on offences of possessing inflammatory material, which starts with Amendment 19, which Liam Kerr has just referred to. And I call Amendment 19 in the name of Liam Kerr, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Liam Kerr to move Amendment 19 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. This is a long committee session. I've no wish to take any more time than required. I have one amendment in this group, Amendment 19, which translates simply, in fact it is, quote, leave out Section 5. Section 5 was one of the most contentious aspects of Part 2 of this bill and is entitled Offences of Possessing Inflammatory Material. It was an area that many committee members expressed concern with, and we heard powerful and compelling testimony in evidence-taking and in written evidence as we prepared our report. I therefore lodged an amendment which would seek to remove Section 5 altogether. Now, I was pleased to note that the Cabinet Secretary supports that move, both in his letter responding to the committee's report and by specifically lodging his support to my amendment in the list. I also note the convener signalled his agreement to this amendment earlier. Accordingly, I don't think there's anything further that requires to be said other than that I move Amendment 19 in my.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to Amendment 47 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, convener. I'm happy to speak to Liam Kerr's Amendment 19. And then a number of our other consequential amendments as well. Section 5 of the bill provides for offences of possessing inflammatory material. This is based on existing provision in the UK Public Order Act 1986. While the offence of possessing inflammatory material is not new, it has existed for the characteristic of race, for example, for a number of years. The extension of the offence in Scotland to the additional characteristics covered by the bill is new. I listened carefully to the oral evidence presented to the committee, but also read through a number of the written responses that committee received, engaged with a number of stakeholders, particularly those in faith groups and also in the creative industries, authors, playwrights and so on. And they expressed to me some deep reservations about this particular offence. And I confirmed in my Stage 1 report response the Scottish Government has therefore decided that Section 5 is not required within the bill, and that's why I'm happy to support Liam Kerr's Amendment 19, which seeks to remove Section 5 from the bill. I've lodged a number of consequential amendments. They flow from the removal of Section 5. In supporting Amendment 19, I've taken the view that conduct which is criminalised by Section 5 of the bill can be covered to a very significant extent, not entirely, but to a very significant extent, by application of the general criminal law in relation to attempts to commit offences, combined with specific offences in Section 3 of the bill. So there's no significant policy or significant practical effect in removing Section 5 of the bill. So I support Amendment 19. I ask members support Amendment 19 as well. That is the other consequential amendments lodged in my name.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. No member of the committee has indicated that they wish to speak in this debate, so can I invite Liam Kerr to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 19?
I have nothing further to add, Convener, so I press Amendment 19, please.
Thank you very much. So the question is that Amendment 19 be agreed to. We are agreed, which means we can go straight to the next group, which is on powers of entry. And I call Amendment 46 in the name of Liz Smith, grouped with Amendments 7, 49, 50, 52, 53, 54 and 101. Liz Smith to move Amendment 46 and to speak to all amendments in the group, please. Liz.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to do so, and I move Amendment 46. Amendments 46, 49, 50, 53 and 54 are all really part of the same point. Put simply, as drafted, Section 6 allows the entry of premises by a constable or a member of police staff. And that member of police staff is defined in Section 6 or as an individual appointed under Section 26 of the Police and Fire Reform Scotland Act 2012. And under Section 26(2)(b) of that Act, that also includes persons provided to the police under arrangements between police and a third party. Now, I note in evidence that ACC Ritchie said to the committee, and I quote, certain powers being exercised by members of police staff, which is the unusual element here. It's that unusual element that is concerning. In the same evidence session, Callum Steele of the SPF said the police are currently having the skills for many roles and the technology to enable them to perform them, but the use of invasive and coercive powers still tends to be reserved to police officers, even if the investigative capacity rests somewhere else in the police service. To reiterate a point he said that we have made in our submission, it is entirely possible that through freedoms that police enjoy, police staff enjoy as members of the public who work in the police service, they could then find themselves using coercive or enforcement powers on other members of the public in the course of an investigation that relates to issues on which they have taken a public position. And he goes on to say that is not a helpful wedge to introduce into a debate on the role of police officers in society or who should have such powers over members of the public. And I agree with that, Convener. But in the final point made in that session, Anthony McGeehan of the COPFS said in relation to this matter, it would not be unusual for a Procurator Fiscal to search a warrant that allowed a uniformed police officer to execute a search warrant with the assistance of other members of police staff, as opposed to a search warrant being executed distinctly by a member of police staff who was not a police constable. That concern should be addressed through the tightening up of drafting in Section 6. Currently, that hasn't been the case, however, and therefore my amendments seek to address the concerns raised by the police and delete the ability for a member of police staff to be warranted to undertake those matters in Section 6. On Amendment 52, Convener, that seeks to pick up the point as drafted Section 6.3 is very wide. I think the Law Society have flagged up concerns throughout that how this will actually operate is very challenging, not least given that no time period is specified for undertaking the conversion exercise and presumably, though not stated, that the cost would need to be borne by the person required to undertake the conversion. That seems not only to be wide but slightly unreasonable. So the Law Society have helpfully suggested some clarification to this by an amendment, which I note is not lodged, to perhaps introduce a caveat of reasonableness in terms of time afforded to convert or produce, and that cost should be borne by those instructing the search. And that's interesting, but it has an impact, obviously, for police costs. So thus, in the absence of the Cabinet Secretary coming forward with proposals to address these concerns, I would like to move the amendment.
Thank you very much, Liz. Could I ask the Cabinet Secretary, please, to speak to Amendment 47 and other amendments in this group? Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Convener. I will speak to all of the amendments in the group. Amendments 46, 49, 50, 53 and 54, lodged by Liz Smith, seek to remove members of police staff from the powers of entry provision in Section 6 of the bill. And Liz Smith, I think, has articulated well where some of the concerns have been raised during the oral evidence sessions at stage one of the committee process. Section 6.1 of the bill enables a sheriff or a justice of the peace to grant a warrant authorising a constable or a member of police staff to enter premises if there are reasonable grounds for suspecting that an offence relating to stirring up of hatred has been or indeed is being committed at the premises, or there is evidence at the premises of the commission of such an offence. And I do appreciate certain concerns were expressed about Section 6 by some who gave evidence to the committee. Again, it was referenced by Liz Smith that evidence was given by the Scottish Police Federation and indeed Police Scotland. They do not regard the inclusion of members of police staff as an essential operational requirement, as police constables would in any event be present and able to enforce warrants. So Liz Smith's amendments 46, 49, 50, 53 and 54 would remove police staff from being subject to the warrant powers. I've reflected carefully and I am supportive of amendments 46, 49, 50, 53 and 54. Now, I do give notice, however, that I would like to consider further ahead of stage three whether any additional changes may be needed to ensure members of police staff can still enter premises where a police constable has been authorised under the warrant power in the bill. But that does not stop me from giving support to these amendments today. Liz Smith's amendment 52, however, is not one that I can support. This is because I think it would unduly hinder the ability of the police to secure evidence in relation to the suspected commission of an offence of stirring up hatred. In the exercise of a warrant under Section 6, Section 6.3 provides the police with the power to require any electronic information to be produced or converted in such a way that it can be removed from premises subject to a warrant. And this could be, for example, in relation to a computer upon which there are reasonable grounds to suspect are stored hundreds of threatening or abusive emails or electronic communications for the purpose of stirring up hatred. And others, unfortunately, we can think of far too many examples internationally, globally, of where stirring up of hatred offences have taken place, and indeed electronic communication has been key to that. That removing Section 6.3 would take away an important part of the powers of entry provided for in the bill, which would undermine the ability of the police to gather evidence. So I'd ask members to vote against Amendment 52 if Liz Smith chooses to press them. Amendment 7 in my name adds a time limit on the exercise of the warrants granted to the police under Section 6 bill. This was an area committee specifically invited me to reflect further and consider in light of the evidence heard. In my response to the committee stage one report, I did commit to bring forward an amendment to limit the period of effect of a warrant to 28 days, and Amendment 7 makes good on that commitment today. And finally, in this group, Amendment 101 in my name concerns the exercise of the power of entry and search under a warrant granted under Section 6 of the bill as they relate to Crown land. This is a fairly normal provision to insert when there are such powers of entry and search in legislation. It exists in many Acts of Parliament, such as the Wild Animals and Travelling Circuses Scotland Act and Forestry and Land Management Act 2018. So accordingly, I would ask members vote for Amendments 7, 46, 49, 50, 53, 54 and 101. Reject Amendment 52.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. John Finney has indicated that he would like to speak in the debate on this group. So can I call John Finney, please?
Thank you, Convener. For the reasons outlined by the Cabinet Secretary, I similarly won't be supporting Liz Smith's Amendment 52, but can I thank Liz for bringing this important issue, and I will be supporting the other amendments. I think there's specifics that relate to this bill that's important, but also there's the general principle of giving extensive powers. I think I noted, quoting Mr. Steele correctly, invasive and coercive. In other words, the ability to gain entry to and search premises, and the ability to detain and arrest someone. These are powers that should only be given out sparingly and they should only be given to sworn constables. Now, that does not mean that police support staff don't play a valuable role in forensic and backing up police officers. It's not about that. It is having a sworn constable exercise these important powers. So I thank Liz Smith for bringing these amendments forward, and I will be supporting them.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Finney. No other member has indicated that they wish to speak in this group, so can I invite Liz Smith to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 46, please?
Thank you, convener, and can I say thank you to the Cabinet Secretary. I thought his comments were very helpful, actually, and also to Mr. Finney, because I think there is an important issue here. I brought these amendments because of what I'd heard in committee evidence relating to comments that were provided by the police themselves, and I think we have to be cognizant of the concerns that they had had we not made these amendments. Can I also say that I have listened carefully to what the Justice Secretary has said regarding Amendment 52, and when the time comes, I will not be pressing that one, but I would like to press the others.
Thank you very much. So the question is that Amendment 46 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 47, the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 19. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Move, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 47 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 48 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 19. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Move.
The question is that Amendment 48 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 7, the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 46. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 49 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 46. Liz Smith to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. That's moved. The question is that Amendment 49 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 50 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 46. Liz Smith to move or not move?
Moved, Convener.
Thank you, that's moved. The question is that Amendment 50 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 51 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 19. Cabinet Secretary to move formally?
Moved, Convener.
That's moved. The question is that Amendment 51 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 52 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 46. Liz Smith to move or not move?
Not moved, Convener.
That's not moved. So I call Amendment 53 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 46. Liz Smith to move or not move?
Moved.
That's moved. The question is that Amendment 53 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. And I call Amendment 54 in the name of Liz Smith, already debated with Amendment 46. Liz Smith to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 54 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. We have three further groupings to debate in stage two, and we're not going to get through all three of those groupings today. So I'm going to draw a line at this point, and we will reconvene next week to continue and complete our stage two consideration of this bill. And next week, when we reconvene, we will commence with the debate on the next group, which concerns removal of provisions ancillary sections 3 and 5. I don't anticipate that the remaining a consideration of stage two will take more than about an hour next week. We don't have an hour today to complete it, I'm afraid, not least because we do have one other piece of business. So can I thank Dean Lockhart, Joanne Lamont, Liz Smith and Hamza Youssef for joining us today. And can I invite members of the committee to stay where they are and not move yet, because we have another item on our agenda which does need to be disposed of in public before we leave the meeting. Thank you very much. And agenda item 2 is consideration of two negative instruments, namely the Police Appeals Tribunal Scotland Amendment Rules 2021 and the Police Service of Scotland Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations of 2020. These are negative SSIs. Do members have any comments to make on these SSIs? No member is indicating that they have any comments to make. Are members content not to make any comments to the Parliament on these SSI? That members are content. So that concludes consideration of the SSIs, and it also concludes our meeting today. Our next meeting will be on Tuesday, the 16th of February, and the clerks will be in touch with the timings. And I now close this meeting.